Arkadaşlar dersimize hoş geldiniz. Mukavemet dersinin 7. hafta konusunu işleyeceğiz. Geçen hafta verilen tatilden dolayı ders yapılmadı ve bu hafta itibariyle 23 Mart haftası itibariyle derslerin uzaktan olarak yapılması YÖKÖ Üniversite tarafından karara bağlandığı için ikinci bir duyuruya kadar derslerimizi bu şekilde uzaktan online devam edeceğiz. Bugünkü dersimiz bulunma konusu. Ders hem Türkçe hem İngilizce bildiğiniz üzere. Dersi ben İngilizce olarak anlatacağım. Önemli gördüğüm yerlerde Türkçe'ye döneceğim. Dolayısıyla hem grup 1 hem grup 2 için aynı dersi yapmış olacağız. İngilizce zaten normalde bu dersi İngilizce'de verilebiliyordu. Statikte de bildiğiniz üzere. Şimdi İngilizce ile birlikte Türkçe'yi kullanarak gerekli gördüğüm yerlerde Türkçe açıklamalar kullanarak ama genelde İngilizce ile dersi anlatacağım. Size bu açıklamaları yaptıktan sonra İngilizce olarak da duyurular yapacağım. Hatırlatmak istediğim bir şey var. Ben ders gruptan dersle ilgili detayları sizinle paylaştıktan sonra bu dersi izleyip notlarınızı alıp çalışabilirsiniz. Dersi izleyen arkadaşlarımızın ders videosunun altına adını, soyadını ve öğrenci numarasını yazmasını bekliyorum. Böylelikle derse katıldığınızı kanıtlamış olacağız. Okay. I just would like to say welcome to the 7th lecture of Mechanics of Materials. As you are well aware, we are continuing our education online, so this is the platform I will be using until the next notice. So please follow this video in regard to the 7th lecture. You know, this is the same lecture for two groups, so I'm going to instruct you in English mostly. But time to time, I will stop and speak in Turkish to highlight some important parts, okay? So, mainly I'm going to speak in English, and I know that you all attended my lectures in English, so I expect you this will be a nice lecture. So today's topic is torsion. Before I start my lecture, I just would like to tell you again that participants should write their names and surnames along with their student IDs at the comment section. That will be the proof of your attendance to this lecture if the situation requires. Okay, so please, at the end of the lecture, just write your names and surnames and your student's ID at the comment section. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about torsion, angle of twist, and as you can see, statically indeterminate shafts, design of transmission shafts, stress concentration, and elastoplastic materials. Okay, so just a quick review about where we left. So it will be, you know, regularly it will be last week, but this is 2 weeks before. So I put some slides to remind you about some important points. Okay, let's use this guy. Or I think the red one is. Okay. So the red one is better. Okay. So you can follow this red dot. Okay. And I think it will be very typical. You are familiar with my lectures, so I use presentation and I do the explanations on the presentation, so it will do no harm for us. I mean, even in face to face or in this video based online lecture, it will do no harm. Okay, so quick reminder. You can see this tau xy is the shearing stress, and this is the Hooke's law for shearing stress. Okay, and you can remember that tau xy equals to the rigidity modulus or the shearing modulus g times the gamma here, which is the shearing strain. Okay, so shearing in Turkish kayma is shown in this figure. Okay, so we have a test element, a square test element, which has L as the length of the sides. Okay, and if we apply forces, okay, parallel to this section here, then we will have the shearing stress. Okay, so this is the shearing strain, the angle of shearing strain, and remember we can find this shearing strain as the distance over the length. Okay, so this was the shearing stress and shearing strain. Okay, and they are related to the Hooke's law in general. And then we speak about the angle of twist. Okay, so remember this circular shaft. Also, please remember that stress, the torsion is solvable if we have the axisymmetric geometry, which we have, which is the circle in our case. And as I told you in the lecture, that the circular shafts are mostly used to transmit the power from one point to another point. Okay, so we are assuming that we are applying a torque at this end, and then this point A is going to travel to point A prime after we apply the torque, and then this is the torsion. And the length of this arc AA prime can be find the radius of this circle and the angle here. Remember, the angle should be in radians, so just go back to our, just check our information on radians and circle. Remember, if this theta is an angle in radians, this length of this arc, which is shown by red, is going to be r times the theta. So this is a simple background information from geometry, from math. So you can simply say that the length of this red arc is going to be the phi, the angle phi in radians, times the radius rho here. And from this point we have the shearing angle, be careful, which is given by this gamma. Okay, and if I would like to write this shape, okay, just draw this shape here. Okay, so this arc here, this blue dashed arc, and this red arc here will have approximately the same length, and the length of this red arc is going to be the angle phi times rho, and the length of this blue dashed arc is going to be gamma times L. So we can typically say that phi times rho approximately equals to gamma times L. Okay, we did this analysis. Remember, we derive the equations as shown here. So this is just a quick reminder. So I will do this reminder in Turkish also. Evet, aradan iki hafta geçtiği için hatırlatmalar, kısa hatırlatmalar yapacağım derste. İlk hatırlatmamız, kayma gerilmesi için Hooke kanununu bu şekilde tanımlamıştık. Hatırlıyorsanız tau x'i g çarpı gamma x'iydi. Kayma gerilmesi, kayma modülü ve kayma gerilimi. Kayma gerilimi de kayma mesafesi bölü uzunluk olarak tanımlanmıştı derslerden hatırlarsak. Burulma konusuna geldiğimizde daire kesitli şaftların burulması konusunu inceliyorduk. Dairenin aksisimetrik bir geometri olmasından dolayı burulma sonrasında dairesel geometri şaft üzerinde herhangi bir noktada bozulmuyordu. Bunları derste tartışmıştık. Burulma olduğunda buradaki A noktası, buradan bir tork uyguladığımızda bu uçtan A noktası, A prime noktasına hareket ediyordu ve buradaki oluşan yayın uzunluğunu buradaki radyan bilgimizden de hatırlayacağımız üzere bir yayın uzunluğu, o yayın açısı radyan cinsinden çarpı yarıçap kadardı. Dolayısıyla biz buradaki yayın uzunluğunu bu yarıçap ve bu açı cinsinden yazabilirdik. Burada da bizim kayma gerilmemiz olduğu için kayma gerilimi olan gamada burada bir yay görüyor. Buradaki şekli, bu A, A prime B şeklini şuraya çizersek kayma geriliminin gördüğü yay ve burada angle of twist dediğimiz burulma açısının, yani phi'nin gördüğü yay yaklaşık olarak birbirine eşit uzunlukta olacağı için rho çarpı phi'yi gamma çarpı d'ye eşitleyerek denklemlerimizi türetmiştik. Şimdi bu dersimizde buradan devam edeceğiz. Okay. So this was where we left off in the last lecture. So I will continue from this point on. Okay. So here we have the angle of twist phi, the radius c, the torque applied, and the maximum shear strain. Be careful. When rho equals c, it will be the outer, the c is going to be the maximum radius. So this is where we have the maximum strain. Okay, so the maximum strain is going to be, if you remember the equation about the arc length, is going to be c times phi over L. And remember from the Hooke's law, the maximum shear strain is going to be the tau max over G. And if you may remember the elastic torsion formulation, tau max, we have this equation. Tau max is going to be the torque times C over J. Remember, J is the polar moment of inertia. If we write T times C over J instead of this tau max, we will have this equation. So gamma max is going to be T times C over J times G. So if you do this simplification, okay, if you combine this equation with this one, okay, so you can write the equation of angle of twist, which is T times L over J times G. Okay, be careful. We have the Hooke's law here. We have the elastic torsion formulation here. And we have the relation between the angle of twist phi and the shear strain here. So if we combine these two equations, this is what we get. And we can write the angle of twist explicitly in terms of the torque, the length, the polar moment of inertia, and the shearing modulus. So this is just a slide from previous lectures. This just shows you the derivation of elastic torsion formulation. So you can just stop the video at this point, try to remember how we came to this part, but eventually we have performed this analysis, this mathematical derivations, and then we find the elastic torsion formulations, which is T times C over J. Be careful. In torsion, we are going to have only two geometrical shapes, which is a solid circle and a hollow circle here. Okay, so the polar moment of inertia is for a solid circle as given, and for the hollow circle as given here. Okay, so let's continue. So finally, at the end of our analysis, we find the equation for angle of twist. Okay, so angle of twist is going to be proportional to the torque applied, proportional to the length of this circular shaft, and inversely related to the polar moment of inertia and the shear modulus, and which makes sense. Okay, so if we have a circular shaft with different diameters, different radiuses through the shaft, we can find the total angle of twist by simply evaluating the angle of twist for each section and then adding them up. Remember, we are performing our analysis in the elastic deformation zone, which gives us the flexibility of using the superposition principle. Then we can solve the problem by dividing it logically and then solving each sections, each part, and then adding them up is going to give us the final result, the final answer here. Okay, so this was just a similar approach to normal shear, normal shear. Okay, so if you have different cross sections, you can just find the deformation, or in this case the angle of twist for each section, and add them up to find the total angle of twist. This is also very similar in our previous analysis. If the diameter is changing as a function of position, let's say this point B is 0, okay, and point A is L, so x equals to 0 here, x equals to L here. So if the diameter is a function of x, then what we are going to do is using the integral approach. Okay, so this is the formulation of angle of twist. So we will continue our analysis and then apply this information to some problems. At this point, I would like to make essentially give a brief understanding of the lecture in Turkish until now. Evet arkadaşlar, bu noktaya kadar yaptığımız şey burulma açısı dediğimiz angle of twist, yani phi'yi bildiğimiz parametreler cinsinden formülasyonunu çıkarmış olduk. Burulma açısı uygulanan torkla ve şaftın uzunluğuyla doğru orantılı. Dairesel kesitimizin kutupsal momenti, yani polar momenti ile ve kullanılan malzemenin de kayma modülü ile ters orantılı gelecek şekilde elde etmiş olduk. Bu analizlerimizin sonucunda artık burada elde ettiğimiz bilgiyi problem çözümünü uygulayabiliriz. Bu slayttaki şekilde görüldüğü gibi farklı kesit alanına sahip şaftlarımız olduğunda her bir kesit alanı için burulma açısını hesaplayıp toplayarak toplam burulma açısını bulabiliriz. Bunu daha önce ders boyunca normal gerilmede, kayma gerilmede çeşitli uygulamalarını yapmıştık. Hatırlatmak gerekirse bizim yaptığımız analizler elastik şekil değiştirme, yani kalıcı şekil değiştirme dediğimiz süperpozisyon ilkesinin uygulanabileceği doğrusal alanda olduğu için çözümleri parça parça yapıp toplayabiliyorduk. Evet, burada da her zamanki gibi eğer daire çapımız mesafeye bağımlı ise integrali kullanarak çözümümüzü bulabiliyoruz. Yani her zamanki gibi sonsuz küçük test elemanlarına bölüp her biri için açıyı bulup toplamak, ki bunun matematiksel karşılığı da integre etmek oluyor idi. Evet, nihai olarak angle of twist, yani burulma açısını bu şekilde formülize ettik ve bundan sonra yolumuza devam edelim. Okay. Now consider we have mechanisms connected with gears, which is very common. So I can think of just the gear shifts in our vehicles as the primary example for such an application. But along with this, we have a lot of applications for gears. You know, for some people, gear is representing mechanical engineering, if you may say. Okay, so now at this point we are applying a torque at this E point for as you look at this figure. Okay, so this is the free body diagram of this mechanism here. So when we apply a torque from this point E, we will have an angle of twist at this EB shaft. Now we represent it as given here, phi EB. So since these two points are not fixed, if we would like to find the angle of twist at this AB shaft, we have to calculate the relative angle, which is the angle of twist here, phi I, minus the angle of twist here, phi b. So this difference is going to give us the angle of twist at this EB shaft. Okay, so if you would like to write the equation, so we have this torque applied to this EB shaft, so we have this length and the polar moment of inertia of this cross section and the shear modulus of this material. Okay, let's continue. Okay, so you should remember some simple physics here. Even so, I will make very explicit. I will make it very explicit for you. Okay, I will have some examples for you. Okay. So let's look at these two gears. Okay, so we have this gear B, we have this gear A, and if we look at them from top down, okay, we will see these two gears as shown here. So this gear B, the small gear, has a radius represented with RB, and this larger gear has a bigger radius represented with RA. Okay, so we have this force and the inverse of this force. Remember, we are always in static equilibrium. Okay, so if you do the simple math here, so this torque and this torque, you can simply see that this torque BE is going to be bigger than the torque AD, because since we have the same force in magnitude, but we have a bigger radius here, since torque is force times radius, we will have a bigger amount of torque at this G or E. Okay, so the ratio is given as 1 to 2, so our A is 2 times of our B. This is given, so we can simply write that the torque AD, the torque at this gear A, is going to be 2 times of this torque at B, which is 2t. Okay, so torque is given here. Okay, this torque is going to be identical to torque here. This is the same shaft, be careful. So torque is F times this amount, so this radius is twice of this, so now we have 2t of torque at this gear A. Okay, so this is very simple. This is very simple physics. Okay, if you can remember that torque is the force times the distance, this is very simple for you to understand. Again, torque at G or A is twice of the torque at G or B, which is 2 times the applied torque T. So the final note here is that, so the torque is 1 half of the torque here. Torque at B is 1 half of the torque at A, but now the angle of twist, or the angle, let's say, the rotation angle, the distance that any point travels at this gear, is going to form an angle which is twice of the angle that's been formed in gear at gear A. So now the torque is 2 times here for gear A, but for the angle, for gear B, it is 2 times the angle of gear A. So you can remember this as the mechanical advantage. Okay, so I will put some simple reminders here. This is simple physics. So if we have a gain in force or torque, I mean, if we are talking about the translational cases, this is force. If we are talking about the rotational cases, this is torque. If we have a gain in this force, we have a loss in distance. If we have a gain in torque, we have a loss in angles. Okay, so I think this will make a lot of sense. I believe every one of you ride a bicycle or so. Okay, so if you have a lower gear, okay, let's say gear 1, okay, you are going to know that the force you should apply will be lower, but your speed is going to be lower. But this, you can see the angle or the force and the torque is inversely related. Okay, so here you can see that, I mean, this is a representation of passenger cars gear torque and speed plot. Okay, you can see that you get the maximum torque at the wheels at the first gear. Okay, remember the bicycle, if you are going up, climbing a hill, you are going to use lower gears. But if you are going down, or if you are going on a plane surface, you have to increase the gear to speed up. This is just the same case as passenger cars. So if you would like to have a higher torque, you will have a lower speed, and as the torque reduces, you will have more speed. So this is called the mechanical advantage. Okay? So if you have a gain from one perspective, you will have a loss in another perspective. Okay, so this is simple physics. Let's go back to our topic. So you know this is 2 times of force. Now this is 2 times of angle. Okay. Okay. So let's do our analysis. Now we are applying a torque here. So we have gear B, which is connected to gear A, to this shaft, and this end is fixed. So this end D is fixed. You will know that there will be no angle of twist at this end. Okay. So how can we write the angle of twist of this gear A? So gear A, it is going to be the torque on this shaft, torque AD, times the length of this shaft over the polar moment of inertia of this circular section and the rigidity modulus, obviously. Okay, so in the previous analysis, we find out that, remember, the torque at this AD shaft is going to be 2 times of the torque of at this BE shaft, which is 2 times of the applied torque. So if I write it there, then this torque AD is going to be the 2 times of the torque applied, and this is my angle of twist at gear A. Okay, so let's continue. Okay, so let's try to find out the relation between the angle of twist at gear A and the angle of twist at gear B. Remember, the distance that these gears is going to travel will be identical if there is no slip, which in this case gears are designed to reduce the slip, remember, so this will of course increase the efficiency. So it is going to be the arc of the distance, let's say the length of the arc of the distance traveled is going to be the angle of the twist times the radius of this gear A. So here you will travel the same amount of arc, okay, and the length of this arc is going to be the radius of this gear times the angle of the twist. So actually this equation or this relationship is actually gives us this relationship between these two gears. So this one has a smaller amount of radius, and obviously the angle of twist will be bigger because the distance that this gear travels will be identical of the distance that this gear traveled. So this is going to have a bigger radius. Remember, the distance traveled is the radius times the angle here. Getting here, this radius times this angle is going to be the distance traveled but for this gear, and the same distance should be traveled from this gear, but now I have a smaller radius, which means that this angle is going to be larger. Okay, so let's go back to our analysis. If you would like to write it as an equation, the distance traveled by this gear A should be equal to the distance traveled by this gear B, which is RA times the phi A. Remember, this should be in a radians. It's going to be RB times the phi B. This should be in radians. So if this is 2 times of this, then this angle should be 2 times of this angle for satisfying this equation. Okay, which gives us that the angle of twist at gear B is going to be 2 times of the angle of twist at gear A. Remember, the angle of twist at gear A is 2 times the torque applied, and so now if I multiply it with 2, it's going to be 4 times the torque applied, and so for the angle of twist at gear B. Okay, so let's continue our analysis. Now I would like to find out the angle of twist at this A. Okay, this is the final point, this is our goal. But remember, the angle of twist at this EB shaft is going to be this angle minus this angle, so phi E minus phi B. So phi E minus phi B, which is going to be the angle of twist at this shaft, is going to be obviously this torque applied, okay, this torque applied, and this length, and so on and so forth. So I can simply write that the angle of twist at this shaft, which is phi AB, is going to be T times L, J, and G. Okay, so now I also know that, remember, this angle is phi E minus phi B. So I have this one, phi EB. I have phi B. So it is a simple final math to find phi E. Okay. So if you write it, phi E is going to be phi EB plus phi B. Remember, phi EB is going to be equal to phi E minus phi B. So this minus goes to positive to this side. And then what you get is phi B is 4 times this, phi EB is just 1 times this. At the end of the day, we have phi E should be equal to 5 times the torque applied L, G, and J. Okay, so let's sum it up. That was a long derivation. So this was our mechanism, and at this point D, this is the fixed end, so we will have no angle of twist, obviously. At this point A, we will have the torque times the LJG. So this is constant for all of them because L is constant. So the circular shaft is constant, the material is constant. So this is the torque applied, and this is 1 to 2 ratio. Then we will have 2 times of the torque at this gear A. So 2 times torque and the constant. And if we would like to go from A to B, okay, so we will have 2 times the torque at this gear A, and then we know that we will have 2 times the angle at gear B, or we can simply write the radius of B times the angle of twist is going to be equal to the radius of A times the angle of twist here, which is going to give us that this angle of twist is 2 times the angle of twist here, which was 2, become 4 here. Okay, so at the fourth level, or at the fourth step, we started from the fixed end, 0 angle of twist, 2 something angle of twist, 4 something angle of twist, and here, if we go to E, we will have the 5 times something. Remember, this is going to be, the angle of twist at A is going to be the torque applied and something. Here we have at this point we have the 4 something, and we know that the angle of twist is going to be at AB, this one minus this one. If we do the simple math, we will have 5 something angle of twist at E. So if you try to visualize it, or if you would like to think about it, this makes a lot of sense, because you are applying the torque here, you will have the maximum deformation here, and the second bigger value in terms of angle of twist is going to be here, and then it is reducing to zero at the fixed end. Okay, so this is the end of our analysis. Now I will repeat this in brief in Turkish, and then you will have one example problem solution, which will be the end of first lecture. Evet arkadaşlar, burada yaptığımız analizi hızlıca sizinle birlikte devam yapalım. Burulma açısı hesaplamaları bunun bu resimde gözüktüğü gibi dişli çaklarda oldukça önemlidir. Dişli çaklar birbiriyle temas halinde olan mekanizmalardır. Genelde bir noktadan bir noktaya tork aktarımında veya bu torkun manipülasyonunda, torkun arttırılması veya azalmasında, tork hız dönüşümlerinde dişli yapıları kullanılır. Böyle bir mekanizmanın serbest cisim diyagramına bakarsak E noktasından bir tork uygulanmış. Burada B noktası sabitlenmiş, fixed edilmiş. Diğerleri hareketli. Dolayısıyla EB şaftındaki açım benim E noktasındaki açıyla B noktası açı arasındaki fark olacaktır. Görece olarak düşünürsek. Bu da EB şaftındaki angle of twist'im, yani burulma açım, uygulanan tork ve devamı, bu formülü zaten biliyorsunuz. Şimdi bu açı, burulma açısı, EB şaftındaki burulma açısı aynı zamanda E'deki burulma açısıyla B'deki burulma açısının da farkına eşit olacaktır. Ve dişli çaklarla ilgili hızlı hatırlatmalar yaparsak, eğer AB şaftına dikey yukarıdan bakarsak, B şaftının A şaftının yarısı kadar bir yarı çapa sahip olduğu gözüküyor. Ve buradaki tork, uygulanan tork buraya da geldiğine göre E noktasındaki torkla B noktasındaki tork aynı olacağı için aynı yapı üzerinden. Buradaki tork da buradaki kuvvet çarpı bu yarı çap olacaktır. Bu kuvvet burada aynı miktarda olacak. Ters yönlü statik denge denklemi gereği. Aynı kuvvet eşit miktarı ters yönlü bir şekilde A çarkında da olacaktır. Bu kuvvetle buradaki yarı çap, buradaki yarı çapın iki katı olduğuna göre bu kuvvetle bu yarı çapı çarptığımızda A diskinde, A çarkında iki katı tork elde edilecektir. Bununla beraber B çarkındaki açısal hareket veya angle of twist dediğimiz A şaftın, A diskinin iki katı kadar olacaktır. Bunu fizikte hatırlarsanız kuvvet arttığında yoldan kuvvetten kazanç yoldan kayba sebep olur veya torktan kazanç eşit miktarda açıdan kayba sebep olur idi fizikten hatırlarsanız. Bununla ilgili örnekleri burada koydum. Özellikle bunu bahsetmek istiyorum. Bir bisiklet kullandığınızda yokuş çıkarken özellikle birinci vitesi kullanırsınız ki maksimum torku elde edesiniz. Hızlanmak istediğinizde de daha yüksek vitesleri kullanırsınız. Araba içinde bu böyledir. 5 vitesli bir araba olduğunu bir sedan araba için düşünürsek maksimum torku birinci viteste, maksimum hızı da 5. viteste elde edecek şekilde bir dişli yapısı vardır. Şimdi analizimize devam edersek, D noktasında herhangi bir açısal değişim olmayacaktır. Çünkü burası sabitlenmiş. Dolayısıyla A diskindeki burulma açısını hesaplamak istersek, bu burulma açısı uygulanan tork, ki uygulanan torkun 2T olduğunu burada analiz etmiştik. Burada bakarsanız, burada bu diskteki, yani A çarkındaki tork, B çarkındaki torkun iki katı olacaktır. O da buradaki T'nin iki katı olacağından 2T çarpı diğeri sabit rakamlarımız gelecekti. Şimdi bu diskler döndüğünde eşit miktarda mesafe kat edeceğinden, eşit miktarda döneceğinden değil, fakat eşit miktarda mesafe kat edeceğini bildiğim için bunlar dişli çark ve kayma olmadığı kabulüyle Buradaki kat edilen mesafe yarıçap çarpı dönme açısı B diskinde, A diskinde de kat edilen mesafe yarıçap çarpı dönme açısı, yani vurulma açısı. Burada iki kat yarıçap varsa, burada yarım, buradakinin yarısı kadar yarıçap varsa, dönme açısı buranın B diskindeki, B çarkındaki dönme açısı, A çarkındaki dönme açısının iki katı olacaktır. Ki bunları matematiksel olarak yazarsak, A çarkındaki kat edilen mesafe, B çarkındaki kat edilen mesafe eşit olması gerekiyor. A çarkının yarıçapı, B çarkının yarıçapının iki katı olduğuna göre, B'deki açı, yani vurulma açısı, A'daki açının iki katı olmak zorundadır bu matematiksel denklemi sağlamak için. Bunu da eşitliğe yazarsak, B dönme açısı, yani vurulma açısı, A vurulma açısının iki katıdır. A vurulma açısı da bu şekilde verildiğine göre, bunu 2 ile çarptığımızda B'deki vurulma açısını bulmuş oluruz. Analizimize devam edersek, EB şaftındaki vurulma açısını zaten başta da bulmuştuk. Uygulanan tork çarpı diğer sabitler. Aynı zamanda EB şaftındaki vurulma açısının E'deki açı eksi B'deki açı olduğunu bulmuştuk. Bunun matematiğini yazarsak, EB var elimizde, B var elimizde. Bu ikisini denklemde yerine koyarsak, E'deki vurulma açısını da 5 çarpı TL bölü JG olarak hesaplamış oluyoruz. Sonuç olarak fixed end D'de 0 bir vurulma açısı, A'da 2 miktar, 2 kadar vurulma açısı, B'de bunun 2 katı olan 4 ve sabit 4 çarpı 1 sabit, E'de de 5 çarpı 1 sabit olarak analizimizi tamamlamış olduk. Bunda da fiziksel olarak düşünürseniz sıfırdan artarak maksimum uygulandığı noktaya gelecek şekilde vurulma açısı hesaplanabiliyor. Okay, so we now have an example problem. So I will solve this once in English only. So I expect the first group to carefully listen to the solution. If you get any troubles with understanding English, you can just stop and play, and so the solution is, let's say, a very generic solution. Okay, so we have a mechanism here with the dimensions and everything. Okay, so it is very similar to our previous parametric solution. So the question is, the solid steel shaft is connected to these gears. And I say that the rigidity modulus, the shearing modulus of this each shaft is 11.2 megapascals, and the allowable shearing stress is 8 megapascals. Then they ask me to determine the largest torque that can be applied here, T0, okay, and the corresponding angle of twist at each shafts. Okay, so let's try to solve this problem. Okay, so our solution strategy, first we will apply the static equilibrium, and then you use some kinetics to find the angular relations, okay, and then we will find the maximum allowable torque, and then we will find the corresponding angle of twist. Okay, so let's take a close look at this gear C and B. Okay, so this is gear C, this is the radius here, okay, 2.45 millimeters. Here I have the gear B with the radius 0.875. Okay, so if you just write the static equilibrium here, okay, so at this gear B I will have the moment of this force, okay, and I will have this torque here AB, which is the identical of the applied torque. Okay, so the sum of these two torques or moments, remember they are the same thing, is going to be zero. So the force times the radius here minus the torque here, which is T0, should be zero, should sum to zero. And it is the same for the G or C. Okay, the force here, remember this force and this force are identical. So this force times this radius should equal to this one, because you know you add them up and then count to zero, which gives you this ratio. Okay, so the torque at CD is going to be 2.8 times the torque at B, or you can write it T0. Okay, be careful, TB is also T0. So you can do this math, or you can simply look at the radiuses and then say that the torque at gear C over the torque at gear B is going to be related to the radiuses. Okay, if you do this math, you find this 2.8 ratio, which has been found in this analysis, and then you can say that the torque at CD, the torque at gear C, is going to be 2.8 times the torque at gear B. Remember, the torque at gear B equals to T0. Okay, so you can repeat the same analysis for the angles. Okay, remember, the distance traveled is going to be this angle times this radius, should equal to this angle times this radius. Okay, if you write it, you find the ratio between the angle of twists at B and C. Now be careful at this analysis. Now the angle of twist at B is going to be 2.8 times the angle of twist at C. Be careful, we have the same gain and same loss. Okay, so the torque at C is going to be 2.8 times torque at B. The angle of twist at B is going to be 2.8 times the angle of twist at C. Okay, so this is just the mechanical advantage we talk about. Okay, so let's find the maximum allowable torque on each shaft. Okay, so let's look at the AB shaft. Okay, we have the torque applied T0. Okay, and then we have this radius. Okay, and this is the elastic torsion formulation. Maximum shearing stress is going to be torque applied times the radius over the polar moment of inertia. Okay, and if you do the math here, the maximum shearing stress should be the allowable shear stress, which is 8 megapascals, as given in the question. And you can find out the torque applied should be this much. So if you repeat the same analysis for CD, now be careful here. You write this equation. The torque CD is going to be 2.8 times the torque 0, okay? And if you, the remaining is just the parameters and math. So you will have two torque values, and this torque value will have 8 megapascals of shearing stress at CD shaft, and this amount of torque is going to create 8 megapascals of shearing stress at AB shaft. Obviously, we should select this one, because if we select this, now this AB shaft is going to be safe, but this CD shaft will have more than the allowable stress. Okay, so the torque zero here should be 5.61. Okay, so the last step is finding the corresponding angle of twist, and this is just the again the formulation. Okay, so the torque, the angle of twist at AB is going to be torque on AB shaft and L times J times G. Now be careful, G values are different. J values, I mean the polar moment of inertia values are different, because look at here, we have the radiuses are not the same. Okay, so just not find one polar moment of inertia and use it, they are different. Okay, so 1 over pi times the radius to the power of 4. Remember, for the solid circle, polar moment of inertia. Okay, G values is 11.2 as given in the question. Elvoli use are also different here, okay? So there's a mistake here. This should be for CD. It should be let's look at it. It should be 36, not 24. There is a small mistake here. Just the solution is correct, but the number here is not correct. Okay, just change this to 36. Okay. So if you do this math, the torque times the length over the polar moment of inertia times g. Okay, so you find this, and remember, the torque at CD is going to be 2.8 times the torque zero. Okay, and if you do the math, you will find this angle. Okay, so the total angle at A is going to be this one plus this one. So this one plus this one. Sorry, here this one plus this one. Okay, so you will get the angle of twist at A and 10 degrees. Again, be careful. At this analysis, the angles we find is going to be in radians unit. You have to convert it to degrees if it is asked. If not, you can just leave it. Okay. But if you would like to write in angles, you should put this small notation here. If you would like to use radians, just put this radians notation. Okay, so this is the end of first lecture, and I will do the second lecture. So you can take a break at this point. Evet arkadaşlar, sorunun çözümünü yaptık. Burada sadece ufak bir hata var. Şu 24 değeri 36 olacak. Onun dışında soru çözümünü açıkça yaptım. Bir önceki yaptığımız şeyden farklı olarak uzunluklar ve çaplar değiştiği için J değerimiz ve L değerimiz farklı oluyor. Onun dışındaki analizimiz birebir aynıdır. Teşekkür ederim. İkinci derste görüşmek üzere.